the solution for humanity.
From this day on, forever be true. Cherish this life that's destined for you. Live your life with kindness and care. Remember, Allah will always be there, be there. Nikahun Mubarakun, Zawajun Mubarakun, An-Nikahu Min Sunnati.
Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalam ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Hunna libasul lakum wa antum libasul lahunna. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Ya ayyuhan nasu ittaqu rabbakum allazi khalaqakum min nafsin wahidah wa khalaqa minha zawjaha. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. My brothers and sisters, I welcome all of you with the Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
May peace, mercy and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. And alhamdulillah, once again, as it's a tradition, that whenever the ladies ring, have the marriage preparatory course, we at least have one session where I do have the opening question and session regarding any questions as far as marriage preparatory course is concerned. Any questions on the marriage issue, before marriage, during marriage, after, inshallah. And still this session is mainly for the sisters. We'll be having more questions from the sister side and a few from the gent side, from the brothers. And I suggested that every four questions or five questions from sisters, we'll have one question from the gent side, inshallah. So if any sisters have any questions, they're most welcome to ask.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
In the current world scenario, wherein big fat Indian marriages have become the norm, what efforts should we take to revive the sunnah of the Prophet, peace be upon him? And what should a simple nikah be like?
Our sister is asking that in today's world scenario, expensive marriages are taking place, extravagant marriages are taking place. What can we do to revive the sunnah of the Prophet? And that's a very good question. But I do agree that today we find that marriage has become more of a show and a fashion. You know, so there are cases where fine, they may do marriage in the mosque, you know, nikah karne ka hai. But then they have the walima and big grounds where they spend crores of rupees, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars, and they want to show that, you know, how much they have. And the mehr, as I told you earlier, maybe 76, maybe just 50,000, 1 lakh a person is spending crores in the marriage. So how much mehr should he give? So this really is not what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. And it is nothing but the verse of the Quran of Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 26-27, where it says, that not be a spendthrift, for verily, a person who's a spendthrift is the brother of the devil. So doing israf is haram in Islam. You become a brother of the devil. What should be done to revive the sunnah? What should be done is that you should set examples and see to it that you make the marriage simple. And that reminds me that when I got married in 1993. That's about 16 years back. And some of you may be aware that my wife is from Pune. So, but naturally, we were discussing where to have the marriage, and so it's a normal culture, in inverted commas, a custom, that normally the nikah takes place in the girls' city if they are not from the same city. So we had a big problem. They said, "Why we should have in Pune?" I said, "No, we should have in Bombay." So he said, "Why should I have in Pune?" I said, "I'll give you a reason why I should be in Bombay. I want to do a simple nikah. I want to set an example." She said, "She wants to do a simple nikah." I said, "There are more people." So finally, I was able to click the deal and have the marriage in Bombay. So we had the marriage in Jama Masjid. We approached the Jama Masjid here in the Coffin Market, which is the largest. And they were reluctant that women should not come to the mosque. Yes, they can, but they can sit at the side and all. So we had a problem. So finally, we were able to convince the Jama Masjid of Bandra, where we could take a school which was attached to the Jama Masjid. And mashallah, we had a nikah. And it was a grand nikah, according to me. Grand in the sense that, though when we told the people that, you know, do make arrangement. And normally in a nikah, how many people come? 100, 150. If you have a nikah in the mosque, how many do you expect? 100, 150. We said, there may be more people, so you're laughing. Abhi tak ki kabhi ye angan ne bhara, this small part did not fill, what do you expect? So it'll have some more chat. I saw laughing. But by Allah's grace, alhamdulillah, there are more than 2,000 people who turned up in the mosque, in the gents, and several few hundred ladies, mashallah. And mashallah, we did start the nikah, I think, about 10 minutes earlier than the time. We had a good khutbah, mashallah. It was simple. fine, people couldn't recognize who was the dulla because I was just dressed up in kurta pajama, alhamdulillah. And we saw it was absolutely simple. And we did print a card, which has become, mashallah, very popular. Many people are emulating it. We mentioned that the best marriage is that in which the least expense is made. Hadith of the Prophet Muhammad. The best marriage is that in which the least expense is made. And then we printed on the card that, oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, guide our marriage to the best of understanding. Picking up the hadith and Quranic verses, and then the verse of the Quran, Surah Rum, chapter 30, verse 21, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put mercy and love between the heart of the men and women. So we did make a card, mashallah, and we distributed. And mashallah, it was a very simple marriage. One person said, itni simple marriage should be an example, video recording hona chahiye. So I said, if I had done video recording, would it have been the simple then? So mashallah, I mean, there was no video recording. It was simple, and there were many non-Muslims who came also, mashallah. Many non-Muslims came for the nikah. It was very simple. Mashallah, we had a problem that now there are many people who are going to come from Pune, so we have to accommodate them. I mean, I'm just telling you, Alhamdulillah has blessed us that we could accommodate in 5-star hotel also, but then that wouldn't be a good example. So finally we thought, what to do? So then mashallah, my sister-in-law, she said that, okay, fine, my brother got 2 flats, so we can accommodate there. The reason was that we want to spend less. Not that we could not afford it. Allah has given us, mashallah, we could have kept all the guests in 5-star hotel. But that would break the rule of a simple nikah. So without hiring a hotel, mashallah, and my sister-in-law's brother, mashallah, Aman Bhai here, and Shine Bhai, so both of them, mashallah, they offered their flat, their twin flat, and we just had the beddings. And it was a simple, and whatever requirement was fulfilled. And in the walima is a sunnah, which should call our relatives and close, that is a sunnah. But we did go a bit different, away from the sunnah, to implement the sunnah. You know, it's a bit different. Away from the sunnah means not the sunnah, the muqadda. But away from the sunnah means we have to call as many friends, good to call friends. But now the norm has become that you do a nikah, as I said, in a mosque, and then call thousands of people in a big ground and do decorations, spend crores of rupees. That doesn't serve the purpose. What we did, we called only immediate. My brother and sister, and my father's brothers and sisters, immediate. And my wife's and same, 19 people. 19 people and about 30, 40 from the orphanage, 40 or 50. And mashallah, remember we spent about 3,500 something on the walima. I remember, mashallah. So it was a sample walima where 3,500 odd rupees, mashallah, and a total about 50, 60 people, out of which, because the hadith says, the best of walima is that in which more poor people are called. So we thought to it that the number from the orphanage was larger than what we had. So we set an example, went to one extreme. Committing excess is haram in Islam. Going to an extreme is not haram. So I'm not saying this is the sunnah, but because it has become a norm where people are calling thousands of people, etc., and flashing their wealth, etc., what we did, what I told my parents, that okay, what we saved, mashallah, with that money we set up the IRF, alhamdulillah, Islamic Research Foundation. And what my parents wanted to give a flat, so I said, okay, instead of that, buy the office of Islamic Research Foundation, and Allah has given barakah. So if we had done the marriage like the way we Allah has given us, mashallah, where we can spend a lot. So here what we have to do, that if you want to revive the sunnah, you have to go a step forward and set an example. Have a simple nikah, best in the mosque, and that's it. Give some dates, that's it. Give dates. And if you have to have a reception, then see to it that if the reception is there, it is simple, it's not extravagant, there's no music, there is proper hijab, there's proper segregation of the ladies and gents. In this way, we should set an example. But the best is, in today's age, have a simple nikah. You may have to give card or call people, but still do it in the mosque, and that's it. Avoid the reception. If you have to give walima, have it at your home. Call a few close people. Don't have to be 19, what I call. It can be 50, it can be 100, it can be 200, but don't see to it that there is a 10-course meal. Fine, you can have a 2-3-course meal, no problem. One sweet dish, dal gosht, or whatever you prefer. And if that money you invest in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your marriage will be more successful and Allah will bless you more. And this is only possible if both the family of the husband and wife, they're of that thinking. So that is the reason if you want to set an example, you have to marry a husband who also wants to set an example. So best part is depending upon the life partner you choose. So all this will only come into play if you choose the right partner. And that is the reason at that time in 90s, I remember, in the early 90s, I mean, my sister was in charge. She was supposed to choose. We could not find anyone, so we had to go to Pune. So mashallah, I had to get from Pune, alhamdulillah, the criteria that we wanted. And now mashallah, this whole thing has spread, and the RF ladies wing was formed, mashallah, and which wasn't there before my marriage. So after the marriage, the work expanded, the work increased, the RF ladies wing was formed. And I told my wife that, see, once I get married, I promise you 4,000 a month. I'll give you 4,000 rupees a month. If you can run the house in that, you can marry me. I'm a doctor, but don't think I will give you lakhs of rupees. And mashallah, she was earning much more than that when she got married. So mashallah, but she agreed. Fine. But now I'm giving more than 4,000 rupees. Allah has blessed, alhamdulillah. That's the minimum I said. So what we realize, mashallah, that if you take a life partner who's of the same view, that is the time you can expand, and that is the time you can grow Islamically, and that is the time you can set more example. If my wife was not a Dai, I would not be able to set example. I would have been able, but maybe I would be able to do 25% what I'm doing now. Maybe 20%, maybe 30%. But life would have become miserable. So what we realize is that if you have to set example to the world, you have to choose a life partner who has the same view and who has the same ideology. So if you want to set example, sister, to revive the Sunnah, not only in marriage, even after marriage, so you have to choose a life partner who's virtuous, and that would be the best, because the beloved Prophet ﷺ said that there are four criteria which you look while choosing a life partner. One is wealth, second is beauty, third is nobility, and fourth is virtue. And amongst them, the best is virtue. So if you choose a virtuous life partner, inshallah, you'll be able to set many examples in society. Hope that answers the question, sister.
And we have indeed made the Quran easy to understand and remember. Then is there any that will receive admonition? Learn the language of the Creator's last testament in Learning Quranic Arabic every Monday, Wednesday and Saturday at 6 p.m. Saudi Arabia and 7 p.m. UAE on Peace TV. A friendly message by Dr. Zakir. Old age home.
Al-Quran, Surah Al-Isra, chapter number 17, verses number 23 and 24 says, Your Lord has decreed that you worship none but Him, and that you be kind to parents. Whether one or both of them attain old age in your life, say not a word of contempt. Do not say uff to them, nor repel them, but address them in terms of honor. And out of kindness, lower to them the wing of humility and say, My Lord, bestow on them your mercy, even as they cherished me in childhood. There is no place for old age in Islam.
Peace TV, the solution for humanity.
Tawheed is our way to salvation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ I have not created jinn and mankind except to worship me. Also Allah says, Verily we have sent into every nation a messenger proclaiming worship Allah and shun false deities. To know more about Tawheed, join me, Salim Al-Amiri, only on Peace TV.
Join the institution advocating the oneness of Allah. Join Salim Al-Amri in Kitab al-Tawheed. Next on Peace TV. Nikahun mubarakun,
zawajun mubarakun. Any other sisters have any question?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
Brother, a woman is prohibited to travel alone without a mihram. She has to be accompanied by one. So is there any specific distance or time period of a journey where she can travel alone? She's permitted to.
Sister asked the question that it's a requirement that when a woman travels, she should have a mihram. Is there any particular distance, particular time period, etc.? Now, depending upon the situation, this is a ruling where if she travels, she requires a mihram. But as the times have changed, today the fuqaha say that as long as she's secured internal in the city, if she's secured and there is no danger, etc., in the city itself, there's no problem. As long as it is outside the city limits, as long as it's not late hours, it's not overnight. So as long as it's not overnight, it's within the city limits at daytime, and if you know the place is secured. If it's within city limits at daytime and the place is not secured, where you find many East Asian taking place, a lot of rape taking place, then it's not permitted. But if you know the place is secured and there are no chances of any harm coming, then she can travel alone. That's what the fuqahas say. So it will keep on changing depending upon the area, depending upon the city, depending on which part of the world you live in. So based on this, if it's secured and there's no problem, but irrespective of the secure or not, overnight, no, or if you're going outside the city limits. But again, if you're going outside city limit in a plane, where you know the security in the airport, and once you enter the airport, it's completely secured, plane is secured. Once you land in a place which is tens of thousands of kilometers in the other side of the world, it may take 4 hours or 5 hours by flight, then also it's permitted. As long as you have a mehram who's dropping you at the airport, then you're secure inside the security, absolutely. You're going in the plane, you're landing, then there's a mehram picking you up. So fuqahas, what they say, in certain situations, though you're traveling tens of thousands of miles, it's preferable to have a male with you, but in extreme cases where it's not possible, it's permitted, it's not haram, because the airline is secured. The airport is secured, security is there, and the person is flying, but there should be a mehram dropping you here and a mehram picking you up there. Hope that answers the question, sister. Any sister on the second floor would like to ask a question?
Assalamu alaikum, brother.
Walaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi.
If a Muslim brother gets married to a non-Muslim and the girl agrees to revert, but her parents say that they want to have a Hindu marriage ceremony first and then a nikah, is the nikah still valid?
So I have a question that if a man wants to marry a girl who's a Hindu but she's willing to revert to Islam, but the parents of the girl say that they would like to have a Hindu marriage first and then have a nikah, is the nikah valid? Sister, if the nikah is done properly, nikah is valid, but the Hindu marriage before, that's not valid and that is haram. For example, if a couple, because of the force of the in-laws side, he does a Hindu marriage, that is haram. It may involve shirk. It may involve things in where you break a lot of Sharia. After that, he does the nikah. So nikah is valid because if he follows all the guidelines of the Sharia, nikah is valid. But that does not mean the thing is right. What it earlier may be shirk. It's haram, but the nikah is valid. For example, someone robs water and does wudu. So robbing is haram, but the wudu is complete. If he does wudu with the water which he has robbed, is the wudu complete? Now wudu is done, he has followed all the proper requirements of the Quran and the Sunnah, washing his face, his hands and feet, everything he has done. So wudu is there, but robbing water is haram. So what I've realized, that same way, nikah is valid. But before that, what he did is haram, so you should not do that. Doing that is totally haram, and it is not accepted. And just to put this question further, some people say that, okay, we'll do civil marriage. Do nikah and civil marriage. Now, once you do civil marriage means you are following the law of that country. And specifically, if it's a non-Muslim country. It happened in a non-Muslim country, can't have in a Muslim country. No one would want to do a civil marriage in a Muslim country. In a non-Muslim country, if you do civil marriage, that means you are bound by the laws of that country. Like in India, you have option to do Hindu marriage, you can do Islamic nikah, or civil marriage, or Christian marriage, whatever it is. Now, once you do Islamic marriage, the government gives you permission to follow Muslim personal law. The moment you marry in the court and do a civil marriage, that means you are saying, I want to follow the law of the country, which overrules the Quran and Sunnah. Having your nikah registered is good. You can marry Islamically, have your nikah registered, that is very good. It's allowed and should be done. But if you do a civil marriage, that means if you do civil marriage and Hindu Marriage Act, the civil marriage carries more weight than Hindu Marriage Act. Civil marriage carries more weight than Christian marriage, carries more weight than Islamic marriage. So here what happens, if a dispute takes place, they will follow the law of the country, not law of the Quran. So when the country is giving you the right to follow law of the Quran, and you choose to decline it, to disobey it, and go for the civil law, it is nothing but kufr, according to me. I haven't heard any scholar saying, but I say it's kufr. Because I know what's a civil marriage. It's kufr means you are saying that the Quran is overruled by the law of the country. No law of the country can overrule the Quran. It's kufr. So if you do nikah and do civil court marriage, when the country is giving you permission to do nikah, why should you do? No, because the in-laws want. Because they were ex-non-Muslims. So this is 100% wrong. It's haram, should not be at all. It is worse than, both are bad. But this is worse because if you do according to that, then which law will you follow after marriage? Hindu marriage law or the Muslim marriage? So therefore, best is only to nikah. If anything what the in-laws want, which is not against the Sharia, you can do. For example, they tell you, okay, wear a kurta pajama. I'll be happy. Okay, wear a kurta pajama. Wearing kurta pajama is not haram in Islam. So if the in-laws ask you to do something additional, which is not made haram or not prohibited in Islam, in the Quran, in Sharia, that if you do to please them, there's no problem. But anything which is against the Sharia, against the Quran and Sunnah, like doing a Hindu marriage or marrying in the church or going marrying in the court, this is haram and should not be done. Hope that answers the question, sister.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
What should a girl who is becoming a doctor do when a husband denies her to practice just because she has to deal with male patients? And also, how should that girl behave with the male patients?
The sister has a question, what should a lady do if the husband prohibits her from practicing because she has to be with the male patients? Answer is simple, you stop seeing male patients. So simple, there's nothing to think about it. How should she behave? She should say, I will become a gynecologist, fine. Or if she's a plain MBBS doctor, I will see only female patients and children. Put up a board that this is a specialized doctor, maybe MBBS or BUMS or whatever your sister. I'm specialized only in ladies and children. No problem. Good, alhamdulillah. And Islam doesn't encourage a female doctor to look at a male patient unless it's an emergency. Neither does it encourage a male doctor to examine a female patient unless it is unavoidable. But normally, it's very common. Most of the females go to the male doctors. And if it is a female doctor, even males go there. That is the reason, sister, inshallah, we are starting the Islamic Research Foundation. We are going to start a few clinics, Medicaid clinics, which will be absolutely free. Anyone earning less than 10,000, less than 15,000 can attend our clinics free. And we have identified some places, inshallah, we'll start with four initially, where we are going to give the best of service. It will be free, but top quality. Where we'll have, inshallah, an air-conditioned premises. There will be two separate cabins. In one cabin, there will be a lady doctor, one cabin, gen doctor. Then there's a separate waiting area for the ladies and children, and separate area for the gents. If a small child wants to see a gen doctor, no problem. The children can go anyway. If they're below the age of 9, no problem. But if it's an adult, ladies see ladies, gents see gents. Even the person taking out blood for blood testing, we'll have a lady taking out for ladies and a gent taking out for gents. The dispenser, you know, you call the compounder, fine, he can be most probably it will be a gent. But he can dispense, they don't have to have the hijab. The receptionist will be a gent. But as far as the doctor is concerned, lady will look after ladies, will examine the ladies, gent will examine the gents. Though there are verses in the Quran of Surah Nur, chapter 24, verse number 30, 31, which says, say to the believing man that he should lower his gaze and guard his modesty. The next verse says, say to the believing woman that she should lower her gaze and guard her modesty. There are exceptions to these two rules. One is when you're looking for a life partner, and second is when a doctor is examining. So this again, if there is a case in which a female is sick and she can't find a female doctor and she has to go to a male doctor, is permitted. Or if she's looking for a heart specialist and there's no lady heart specialist, then she goes to a gent, no problem. So a gent doctor can see a female patient only in cases where it's unavoidable, where a male doctor is not available, or she is specialized in a field in which a male is not specialized. So in these two cases are the only cases where Islam permits, but now we find generally it's very common that male doctors look at both the patient. So sister, in your case, it's very easy. You tell your husband, Jazakallah, and inshallah, maybe your practice will flourish more. Maybe. See, you have to do things. Go to the Sunnah, like I remember, I was in Dubai, and I was just there 2 weeks back, and I stayed in a hotel, Taj Hotel, which was the first five-star hotel in Dubai which was without alcohol. Because, you know, having alcohol is compulsory if you want to get a five-star, except in Saudi Arabia and some countries. But if a country where alcohol is not made haram, the people authority make it compulsory, you should have five-star. Though The franchisee was Taj, non-Muslim. Taj, the Tatas. But the local owner was Jumal Majid. MashaAllah, he said, no, I don't want it. He said, won't, it doesn't matter, it's my hotel. You want to give your franchise, give, otherwise no. Tata said, okay, no problem. Tata's only franchise, it's owned by Muslims. Most of the hotels are owned by Muslims. But in fact, all the five-star. Now he told me somebody else is copying and starting another five-star hotel which is free of alcohol. So he started a five-star hotel without alcohol. MashaAllah, even the dress code, that you have to have proper dress code, you know, not too casual, etc. And MashaAllah, separate for ladies, separate for gymnasium, separate for ladies, separate for gents, trying to follow Islam as much as possible. And Alhamdulillah, it is very expensive and it's always full. MashaAllah. It is one of the most expensive hotels. The rates are very high. Flourishing. The system, MashaAllah, even you can have a separate only for ladies. If you want, you can charge high if it really works, MashaAllah. No problems. And inshallah, sister, you can please your husband, please Allah also, and please yourself also, inshallah. Hope that answers the question, sister. Wa akhir da'wan, alhamdulillah, rabbil alameen.
Forever be true. Cherish this life that's destined for you. Live your life with kindness and care. Remember, Allah will always be there, be there. Nikahun mubarakun. Zawajun mubarakun. An-nikahu min sunnati. Ma qala an-nabi huwa sahih. Nikahun mubarakun. Nikahun mubarakun. Zawajun mubarakun.